There's my music. Start me up, baby. Monday. Mick Jagger is still performing. Amazing. They wheel him out in a wheelchair or something. How old is he now? How old is Mick Jagger?
78.
Something
like that. He's in his
70s,
I think.
He's in his
70s. Mick Jagger is
73, and he's still rocking and looking like he... I think they don't need the money anymore. I think they just love what they do. I think they just love it. Let me see. Are we recording? We are recording. Hi. Everybody like my background? Do I have an appropriate background there?
Yes.
Not bad. Good morning, Sean. Sean, you're on twice there. Steven is on, my new guy. Everybody say hello to Steven, the new guy in the neighborhood.
Hey, Steven.
Hi, Steven.
He's from my old haunting grounds, Tom's River, New Jersey. Land of good pizza. Bailey is here. Good. I want to talk today about a really great subject. The EQ, the emotional quotient in sales. How important is emotion in sales, whether it's our own emotion or somebody else's emotion? How important is it? Or should we just read scripts? And just ask for the order five times or more? Has everyone met that salesperson?
Yeah, definitely.
Very annoying salesperson. What goes on in the mind of the prospect when they meet the typical repetitive salesperson? The typical guy or girl says the same old stuff all the time. What do you think goes through their head?
Oh no, not again. How can I get out of here or get away from this guy?
Yeah.
I learned this symbol. It says, get to the point.
Yeah. What do you think the prospect wants? They want information, right? They're shopping for price. How many prospects? We've been prospects, right? When we're buying a car, buying anything, do we shop for price? Yeah, if you're a good consumer, you always shop for price. You look for the best deal. But is price always the determining factor? Are there other factors that we can immerse in there?
Sure.
Change the whole thing. I'm one guy who works out of different houses in different states. I'm still in North Carolina. I decided I'm going to stay here till Thanksgiving and then go back to Colorado or California. And I'm just one guy who picks up the phone and I talk to people every day. I do deals all the time. I do consultation. I do my own deals. I love it. I don't want to say I'm Mick Jagger, but I'm doing something I love. Because I just love, how many people here love the challenge of sales? Just the challenge of it, you know, persuading another person of the value of your product, your service, maybe yourself. Do we sell ourselves? Anybody here? Was anyone in this room ever 17? Okay. Do we remember?
Definitely. You're always selling yourself.
Yeah. It was very nerve-wracking though, wasn't it? It takes a long time to get that wonderful thing we call confidence and all that. So we're going to talk a lot about emotions. I think we need to control our own emotion. Anybody here ever do a sale and you had an annoying prospect or you were losing your patience? Anybody here ever lose control of their emotions in a business negotiation or prospecting or something besides me? Yeah. Mm-hmm. What happens when we get emotional in sales? When we get emotional in sales, what happens?
You lose the sale.
Yeah, you definitely lose the sale. You get ticked off, you get off the phone, you grumble. Do you want to make more phone calls? Do you want to do more business if you're in a really bad mood because you can't control your emotions? Do some people love to hit your hot button? Did you ever meet that person? I know you have. Have you met that person who knows how to hit your hot button and you totally lose all your intelligence, all the great stuff that we talk about here all the time? You know, some people just know how to do it, don't they? Do we see it in politics?
Yeah.
We see it a lot in politics lately, don't we? Mm-hmm. Okay. without getting political. We're not going to get political. I'm not taking a stand left, right, up or down or anything. But do we see some politicians who really know how to manipulate people emotionally? Okay. And people don't always make the brightest decisions when they get emotional, do they? They do things. They do illegal things. They do inappropriate things. They lose their ethics. Have we seen this in the last 2 years? What about with this pandemic? Are people pretty emotional about this whole thing? It was in the old. A year ago, you couldn't use the T word, Trump, at a dinner table without somebody getting into an argument or getting loud. Today, if you talk about the vaccine or the pandemic or something, oh my God, it's the same thing, isn't it? If we can learn to control our emotions, we become much more intelligent salespeople. We can actually learn. Even if we want to, we can actually learn to act. I was talking with Stephen today about acting. Stephen's an actor. He's a real actor. He was in stuff. And what were you in again, Stephen? What kind of movies and stuff were you? You were in my favorite show with Larry David. That's right.
Yeah, curb your enthusiasm.
Famous guy here.
Not that famous.
We'll make you famous.
Curb your enthusiasm. Curb your enthusiasm.
How many people here love Curb Your Enthusiasm? Which episode were you in? So I'll look for you.
It was like season 3, I think episode 11. I was on the plane. That was about it. I'll show you the clip. Yeah.
Yeah, get the clip, man. We'd love to see it. You know, it's how important is it to be a good actor when you're an actor. You're kind of putting a cover over your emotions, aren't you? You may feel one way, but when you're on the stage or the camera, do you have to act another way? Isn't that what acting is?
Mm-hmm.
If you're having a bad day and you have pardon the language, you have a script, you're in a play and you have to act joyful, are you allowed to let your bad day interfere with that character on the stage or camera?
No.
You have to do the same thing in sales all the time. Absolutely. Anybody, let's have some questions. Open forum time. Hi, Alex. Hi, John Andres. Hi, Yiming. You guys, I'm glad you turned on your video there. Tracy Phillips is in the room. The richest man in the room, Tracy Phillips, is on. He just had that big sale he told us about last week. Anybody have a question or a role play or something they'd like to share with us? This is show and tell time. Robert Fendler.
Seeking some advice. So I've acquired a property in Mississippi and it's in a really nice area as far as recreational. So we've been thinking about going Airbnb with it, but I've been doing mostly buy and holds. So I'm just kind of like a little torn with whether to go with the Airbnb or not. My partner has run some numbers. The numbers look great, but to get there is spending a lot of money. Whereas if we were to just turn around and sell it with an owner finance, we could generate income tomorrow. I mean, I've got a list. The person who wholesaled it to us has a list of lease option buyers and owner finance type buyers. So I'm kind of like tossed.
Well, do you want passive income or quick capital gains?
Well, it's not, they're both would be passive because we would do owner finance. So there'd be no quick capital gains. It's just, there's more money to be spent in the upfront for an Airbnb because we'd have to furnish the house and everything.
Okay. So do you want a big chunk of change or do you want a little amount of money every month?
Well, obviously, we're in it for the cash flow. So
which one? What kind of cash flow? What's your budget right now? Do you really need the money right now? Because do you need the money right away? Do you need a cash infusion, or is your budget set up that you can invest, fix it up, and get small amounts of money over a long period of time?
Right. That's a good question. I'd have to really sit down and figure that out. I mean,
this is your moment. You're sitting down right now. Go for it. What do you really need? True. Here, give me, let me get to face. You really need? Here's your injection, your truth serum injection. What do you really need?
I would like to just have the house cash flow right now.
Okay. And what do you think it can cash flow? What are you predicting right now? Are you going to rent it or rent to own it or sell it? Or
we would do either a lease option or owner finance. And our monthly is only $300 a month to pay back the note we have on it. So, and it could cash flow. I mean, well, it could bring in probably close to $1,000 or more a month minus the $300.
I have some coffee.
Brandon wants coffee. Like, does anyone have a cup?
I'll take one.
Okay. I'm sorry. I know y'all can hear me.
So the potential is we could make $1,300 to $1,600 a month with the Airbnb after all the expenses are paid.
Okay. So you want to keep it as an Airbnb, right? Or rather than sell it. Have you done your homework? Do you know for a fact you can keep it filled as an Airbnb
week to week? That's a good question. I mean, it's hard to know for a fact, but in this area, they supposedly have fish tournaments all year round. And so there's only about maybe 6, 7, 8 Airbnbs in the area. So
have you called up those other Airbnbs?
I haven't, but I believe my partner has.
Okay. And what did your partner say?
He said that they are, I don't have the numbers in front of me. I know it wasn't 100% full year round. I want to say closer to maybe 80%.
Okay.
But he said even at 50%, we would still profit well.
Okay. So you can keep it filled 80%. You've done your due diligence. Well, you know, one of the things I do when I'm looking or researching a property, I go to the neighbor's house.
Right.
If it's a condo or I go and knock on doors. It's about the only door knocking I do nowadays. I'll go to the neighbors. Hi, I'm thinking of buying this home here. What do you think of the neighborhood? I'd love your opinion. Guess what happens if you get them to open the door?
Well, they'll tell you the truth.
They'll tell you. Yeah. They love talking about themselves, their neighbors and stuff. Love when I get a senior citizen opens the door. I love it because they'll tell me everything I want to know.
Yeah. This is in Mississippi. I'm still in California.
Okay. How are you going to manage it? How are you going to manage it? Now that you know there's a demand, you've got a good contract that'll cash flow.
Yeah.
You have to sink in some money for repairs, you said?
Yeah, which we've already done the repairs. Now it's buying all of the furnishings.
Okay. To me, it always comes down, do I need a big influx of cash today? Or would I rather just manage it and get passive income that month to month? That extra $1,000 every month.
And that's the thing, we're on a 7-year contract with the seller, so we could run it as passive income for a couple of years and then turn around and sell it. Okay. And it would be worth even more when we sell it.
What do you guys think? Should he just rent it out as an Airbnb, or should he sell this to somebody else? Let them do all the heavy lifting.
Sell it.
Why?
The property management is pretty expensive for Airbnb. It runs around 25 to 30%.
Have you found a Robert? That's a good point Alex brought up. Do you have a management company?
No, my partner is going to manage it at least initially until we, you know, get it off the ground, and then we'll probably look into a management company. Okay. Probably local.
Are you prepared? That's something you might want to investigate now. I hope your partner is willing to do it for a few months, right?
Yeah, he is.
Okay, good. So Bailey says sell it, and Alex says rent it if you can manage the if you can absorb the management company. Is that right, Alex?
Yep.
Yeah.
Okay. So we have two opinions here.
Hey, Claude, I got an opinion.
Go ahead, Tracy. Turn on your video.
We'll do.
Show us what someone who just made a lot of money looks like.
There's the winner.
Okay, so I have a property management company. The 25%, from my experience, would be if the property management company is going to come in and furnish. Typically, you should be paying anywhere between 12 and 15 if you're going to do the furnishing. 15%, especially in Mississippi, I don't I can't speak with the rate that's common in Mississippi, but that's typically what you should be looking for. And really, you really want to get somebody who's experienced and can, if you're going to do that, experienced and can actually keep your place booked. So you might be giving up 15%, but it's worth it if they're, you know, able to get you, you know, above, you know, $100 a night, and keep you booked 80% of the time, because it will all level out.
Well, thanks, Tracy.
Good stuff. Well, so when do you start marketing this property? Is it ready to be marketed?
Probably in the next 2 weeks. We have to order materials or order the furnishings and everything and get that in. I think my contractor didn't call me on Saturday, but I got to call him today and find out he was supposed to finish Saturday. Okay.
It sounds to me like you're able to scale this property. You've done your homework. You know the demand for the property. You've investigated. Yeah. You've done the repairs already. You know what the market will pay and would absorb. It sounds to me like you've scaled this really nice. You're able, if you can do everything you said. You know, we're always on a honeymoon in the beginning of a deal, right?
Yes.
Okay. Where do you think there's a trap anywhere in this?
I just think that the occupancy rate is, I'm not certain on the occupancy rate as my partner is, but when I went back and looked at the numbers in the area, the projected income he was scaling with in that area was between like $180 and $300 a day, depending on, you know, the size of the homes, of course. So okay, that factor shows me that, you know, if we only have to cover about 500, I mean, basic 500, and then there's more costs, of course.
Sure.
So
Airbnb, yeah. Airbnb, I don't know the percentage, but they take a chunk out too, don't they?
3%.
That's not bad.
No, not bad at all.
So between the management company and Airbnb, you have a gross $1,000 a month after your payment to the owner.
Yeah, it's not too bad.
It's not too bad. I'm not hearing any traps here on this thing. I mean, if you told me, Claude, I need a big chunk of cash for another deal I'm working on or the cable bill is due, then I'd say just sell this to somebody else, take a quick cash infusion.
Right.
But it seems to me passive income I love passive income.
Yep.
What's the danger in real estate? What's the danger in real estate that we all go? Stephen, I was talking about it this morning. A feast and famine, right? 1 month.
Yeah, making that money 1 month, and then the next month you're not really sure.
Yeah, and that's something, unless you can get enough momentum, and to me the passive income in between the big deals, until you can get enough marketing going, so you want to be in a position where you 5 to 7 deals a month you're juggling. Two are on hold, one dies, one's renegotiated, one closes. And then all of a sudden, the next month, 2 deals close. And then you find 3 or 4 more deals. You've got to constantly be putting those deals in the funnels. But sometimes you go a month, another month, no cash, right? And you got to live. You got to pay your bills. You don't want your lifestyle to be that crazy. And so in between, owning a few properties where you're getting consistent positive cash flow was my daughter's first 3 words. You can teach your kid worse things, right? You know, getting that passive income. I talk a lot about consulting all the time. Why? Why do I love consulting?
Passive income.
Passive income. Money coming in. I have 2 appointments this afternoon in different parts of the country, one in California, one in Texas. And both of them have problem deals or problem real estate issues. And they're both probably properties I don't want to touch. I don't like the numbers. I don't like the location. It's not my kind of deal. So what can I do? What can I do with a property? We get these all the time where they're upside down, the numbers wrong, too much money invested in the repairs, not the right location. What do we do with those properties? What do we, in that first phone call on Zoom, where do we segue to?
Wholesale.
Consulting.
Consulting.
Can you make money? Can you make money today consulting on a project? Sarah, I have a few solutions for you. I have a few ideas for you.
Sure.
Why don't you set it up as a lease purchase? Why don't you do a subject too? How about owner finance? How about an Airbnb? I just talked with Mr. Fendler on this, and I can put us all together and everything. I'll charge you a reasonable fee, and I can help you with the paperwork and everything else. Boom.
So, go ahead, Bob, Robert. When you do the consulting, do you get them to pay you up front? I've been putting pay me at the day of closing. Do you get half up front, half at closing? How do you structure?
Do you want to be a bus or a taxi?
A bus.
Why?
Will that be Visa or MasterCard?
Yeah. You pay when you get on a bus, right?
Yes.
A taxi, you pay when you arrive.
Right.
I'd rather you will always want some skin in the game up front. You always want, why are we in business?
Make money today.
Okay. So you do it, you have a consultation deal on a $500,000 property, and they agree to pay you $6,500. But they don't want to pay the whole amount. So can you create a note and get a down payment today, some monthly payments, and the balance at the close? Could you structure something, a note like that? Would that be hard?
No.
How good is that passive income? So you pick up $3,500 on a Monday afternoon, or $1,000 on a Monday afternoon. And what can you do with that money while you're juggling your real deals?
Yeah.
Survive, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
Stay in survival. Don't let your business control you with feast and famine until you get enough momentum. There's other ways to generate income. Good topics, good stuff today. Good morning, Randy. Good morning, Suzette. And everybody, and who else joined me? Anybody? Mr. Cash Offer is even here. Anybody else have a question? Open forum here before we start doing some role playing and talk about emotions in sales. Anybody else? Guys are quiet. Whew, listen to that. I could fall asleep. It's so quiet. Oh my gosh. Let me share a screen with you right now. This is, can you see my screen? Can everybody see it? Okay, Stephen, unmute yourself there.
Yes.
This is Newman the dog. I want you to sell that dog to Mr. Robert Fendler. Sell that dog to him, that cute dog. Look at that face. This is my one of my best friends. His dog is Newman. Newman was a rescue dog. He was found locked in a closet in Tijuana, Mexico. He is the most lovable, wonderful dog in the world, the most grateful dog in the world. Okay, he's a rescue.
Is your buddy a Seinfeld fan?
I don't know. Why do you say? Why is that? Why'd you bring that up?
Hello, Newman.
Oh, okay. Hey, you came out of left field on that one. Oh my God. Newman the postman. Go ahead, Stephen. You've got, I'll give you 60 to 180 seconds to sell Robert that dog emotionally. Don't tell him about the breed. Don't tell him about how, sell him emotionally to Robert.
All right. How you doing, Robert?
I'm good, Stephen.
Let me ask you this. Do you have a dog?
I do.
No.
Oh, no, I don't have a dog.
You don't have a dog.
Make it easy. No. For
I don't have a dog.
You don't have a dog. Okay, so you're putting me on the spot.
How about mine? Who wants to take over? Who wants to sell a dog today? Nobody. How do we sell a dog? What are the emotions of a dog? Let's hear. I'll tell you what. I'll show you guys a video first. I saw this video on TV last night. Okay. And I said, oh my God, what are they doing here? This is from Subaru. Let me know if you ever saw this video. And it's amazing.
Subaru presents The Underdogs. They may have lost an eye, or their hearing, or their youthful good looks, but there's a lot of things these remarkable dogs haven't lost, like their ability to lick, wag, and love with the best of them. Join Subaru in helping underdogs find a loving home and celebrate all dogs during our third annual National Mega Dogs Day.
God, you had me.
What?
You had me at Subaru.
I saw this last night. You know, I believe it or not, I think of these themes. I start on like Saturday. Oh God, what am I going to talk about on Monday? And last night I was watching TV and this Subaru commercial came on. And most commercials, what do? They're so stupid or insulting or boring, right? But every now and then, one of them captures, either make you laugh, or they're, God forbid, interesting, or they want to touch your soul a little bit. They want to, you know, okay. Why do you think Subaru, a car company, they want to talk about their car, 0 to 60, it's good in the snow, it comes with a sunroof. Why is a car company talking about injured dogs, rescue dogs? You ever think about this? They probably spent a fortune on this commercial. Why? I always ask why questions.
Because you want to do business with a company that is caring, that maybe has the same emotional things that you're interested in, finding homes for good dogs.
You hit on it pretty close. Things you're interested in. You're close, David. Keep rolling with that. Things you're interested in. Help them out, somebody.
Commonalities.
If they can relate to you, if you can relate to what they support, then they're the kind of business you want to do business with.
So, let me see if I can find my notes here. Why dogs? Here's my mind map for the day. Subaru owners are actually twice as likely to have a pet as other car owners. And 7 out of 10 Subaru drivers share their heart, home, and of course their back seat with a four-legged family member. Subaru knows that dogs are family, as evidenced in their dog-tested, dog-approved commercials in 2018. Going back a little. dyslexia kicks in every now and then. What do you think they're doing showing these dogs to people?
Because your heartstrings.
Right.
They're just trying to attach to people that are into dogs, like for that one little commercial.
One little commercial here.
Is that social proof?
Ooh, let's talk. What's social proof? Help me out, Brandon. What is social proof?
Something validated by society, by everybody feels or has already signed off on it, so it's acceptable to the masses.
Yeah. Yeah, it's so what everybody else does. Don't we want to do what everybody else does?
Yep.
Or don't we want to work with somebody? You know, if I go to you and I say, Brandon, you know, I'd love to spend more time with you. I know you're busy and you want to talk about your house and everything, but I am so busy. I have 8 appointments today. I have 5 phone calls. I have Post-its. Why do you think I'm so busy as a professional lease purchase investor, Brandon? Take a guess before I go.
Why I think you're so busy?
Yeah, why am I so busy? Help him out, somebody. Why am I so busy? Why did I make it a point to tell a prospect how busy I am?
Oh, because
you're in demand.
I would feel like, oh, he's busy, so I definitely want to do business with him.
Two of the most powerful emotions or psychological triggers that you can use are where you're taking scarcity. I'm very busy. I don't have much time for you, Mr. Prospect. I know you got a lot of questions. The only thing I want to know is, can I ask you 2-3 real quick questions and I'll make you an offer? Is that all right, Brandon? Do you mind?
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Oh, good. Thank you. You do mind? I'm sorry?
I don't mind.
Oh, thank you. Just a couple quick questions and boom. And but because I'm very busy, I've got all these calls. I'm working on several other deals. So social proof and scarcity. Social proof means that other people see the value in your business. Other people are doing business with me. I consider myself a valuable commodity. Should I communicate that to somebody without sounding like a braggart?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
You better believe it. I am unique. I do some. See, when we're talking to people, do we have to have the phony stuff? Do we have to have the big office, a lot of employees, all the shiny, blinky little things? Or can we just say to that person, you know what? Before I do that surgery on your left ear, Brandon, I just want you to know I've been doing this for 30 years. I'm great at repairing ears, rebuilding ears. I'm the best plastic surgeon when it comes to earlobes. And you have nothing to worry about, sir. But if you're still thinking about it, that's fine. But I'm going to have to move you back to, I'm going to have to move you to 2022, late 2022. I do have an opening though in the end of October, if you like. Do you, how do you feel about that? What do you think, sir?
I will go ahead and get something plugged in as soon as possible.
Boom. Scarcity and social proof. Real valuable. One more. You like dog commercials like that one? Let me show you another one here. Let me hit my share screen. Let me pull this up. I got a good one here. It's a very long commercial. So I kind of cut it there. And it shows a young girl. She's like a 12-year-old girl and she gets the puppy and she's growing up and she breaks up with her boyfriend and the only friend, and she's heartbroken, but the friend, the dog is still there. She goes out on a date with a guy who tries to put his arm around her and the dog comes up in the living room and starts growling at the guy's crotch. Okay. And it's her friend through a lifetime. And then it's Chevy. What is Chevy doing here? What are these car companies doing to dog owners when they know that 7 out of 10 pickup truck owners or Subaru owners or Chevy truck owners have dogs? 7 out of 10. Is that a good marketing segment of the market there?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Isn't it interesting? They don't talk about the engine. They don't talk about all the, you know, the heated steering wheel, the vibrating seat, the beep beeps when you back up with the TV camera and the thing. They're talking about the buyer and the dog, and then it's subtly the car at the end.
All about relationship.
Relationship, the car, they're using emotion rather than features and benefits. I find this fascinates me.
You can depend on us like you could depend on your golden retriever.
Yeah.
Is that establishing rapport up front, that building that rapport?
Rapport?
Like, what do you mean? Like and trust.
Like and trust, another psychological trigger. When we like and trust somebody, when we like and trust a salesperson, how easy is it for them to close us?
Easy.
Stefan, you and I met for the first time this morning. What did you say to me after 36 minutes?
That you gave me a lot of value. You know, I trusted what you had to say.
And we made an agreement, didn't we?
Mm-hmm.
Right away, first phone call. You have to create value in people. They have to see value. There's no getting away from that. You have to be able to remove the pain or solve the problem or give unbelievable value when you're negotiating. Buying, selling, investing, real estate, life insurance, selling great carpeting like Randy does, anything. It's all the same. It's all the same psychology, basically. But it's fascinating to me the way they use those kind of touching things with the dogs. What other kind of emotions do people use when they're trying to persuade and influence us? What are those? Are there any other emotions?
Fear.
Fear.
Greed.
Fear. Greed. I like fear. Mm. If you are, let's talk about that for a second. Alan, Mr. Brian.
Hello.
Yeah, if you were you're selling an alarm system today to Alex Gullion, who has a 95-year-old grandmother living with him, and he has to travel a lot, and you're an alarm salesman. What are you going to sell to Alex Gullion? Are you going to tell him all about the circuit boards and all the things that your alarm company has? What are you going to say? Alex loves his grandmother who lives with him. What are you going to sell to him?
Fear.
What emotions come into play here?
Fear.
Fear of what? Go ahead, sell him. You're on.
Okay.
This is called
Alex. Hey, Alex, I understand you're a traveling salesman. I mean, it must be an exciting job being able to jet set and go everywhere, right?
Yeah, it's exciting, yeah, for sure.
And how's Nana back home? I'm sure everything's good with her, right? I mean, she lives solo with the Chihuahuas. I mean, what could go wrong?
Yeah, she fell the other day. I'm scared that she might break her hip next time.
Oh my goodness. I mean, there isn't somebody there that's taking care of her that could be on the lookout for her, is there?
Yeah, we have nurses coming like once a day, but we do have to worry about her on weekends and evenings.
Well, I mean, what would you have to worry about? I don't understand. It seems like everything's taken care of with the nurses.
Well, when we're not there,
she's gonna run out of time.
She could fall and hurt herself.
Oh, okay. Well, before I go, and I'm really busy, in the event that we could set something up for you whereby you could have a close contact with Nana over there in the event that she falls or anything, God forbid, happens, such as breaking and entering, because I see that the neighborhood has changed. I mean, that isn't something that you'd be able to sleep with at night, is it?
No. I want to think about that.
Time out. What did he just insert into that conversation? It was very good, Alan. What did he just insert? We were talking about Nana falling and stuff like that and communication, but what did he just throw into the mix there? We were talking earlier about fear.
Danger.
Danger to grandma. Alan, you kind of slid. It was brilliant that you brought that up. Could you elaborate on it very gently, very nurturingly? You know, I'm a little worried. I did some homework on your neighborhood. Do you know you've had a few break-ins lately? There was, that kind of concerns me a little bit about your home. And you're gone. What did you say? You're gone a week at a time and stuff like that? I don't know if that's important to you. Boom, something like that, Alan. Go ahead. You got a minute left. Close them.
Yeah, Alex, I mean, you mentioned to me that you seem to be gone all the time, and given all the transactions and sales you've been doing, I mean, it isn't a concern for you, given the fact of how, you know, two blocks away a week ago, there was that case whereby half of the house was gone and the copper pipes were removed. I mean, that's not something that you'd want to probably take care of and make sure that Nana's secured, is it?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, I couldn't believe I heard that about that.
Certainly. I mean, in the event that this is something that you could set up at your house, I mean, what's your time frame like? How soon would you want to make sure that she's okay? I mean, I see that your schedule's really booked and you're about to fly out again.
Yeah, if we could take care of this, you know, either tonight or tomorrow, that'd be perfect.
I mean, the bookings except, right now.
Accept yes for an answer. He just gave you the close. You don't have to work anymore. You're done.
He just said, tonight.
You can do it now. Close him. Take his money.
Okay. Tonight, I appreciate that, Alex. Our calendar is really booked, but I think I'm going to be able to squeeze you in at 8 p.m. tonight. But, you know, it's going to require.
No.
I actually have a technician in the area, Alex. I mean, we could do this right now. I mean, would you like to place a deposit right now so that we can get this done?
Yeah. What do I have to do?
Hold a gun to his head and so he'll take your money.
Visa, Master, American Express.
Yeah, exactly. Take Alan, you did a great job, but learn to take yes for an answer.
This is working on it. Thank you.
You know what worries me sometimes about you guys? You're so worried about the agenda qualification closed. You're not allowed to think about it and all that stuff.
Skip the shit and close.
Oh shit, Claude told me to say this. No, take the money.
Get off the script. Improvise.
Lesson learned. Lesson learned. off topic. I went to the bank Friday, so I just want to give a shout to the gut sales method. So there you go.
Tell us about it real quick, because we're time's going fast.
Okay. This was a partnership for a lease purchase. I tried working with this investor a few months ago, but on two contracts, but it didn't pan out. So I was able to work this one with him on his deal. And fortunately, after 8 minutes and 38 seconds, we were able to secure this guy, have him look at it that same day and submit the application. And the next day, or rather Friday, get paid. So there you go.
He has a 9-minute sand glass.
That's great.
You didn't make any money, did you?
I did. So, I'm thankful for it. I mean, it's not Claude Diamond level type of money, but someday I'll get there.
No, listen, if you made $50, $500, $5,000, $50,000, it all is cumulative. It all adds up at the end of the month. This is why I'm so repetitive on passive income versus your big capital deals. Okay, money, make money every day, even a little money at the end of the day. Everybody ever watched the, it's the one video I show in my one present in my in-person presentation, Joe Atis. It's the old guy who sells the carrot peelers on the streets of New York City in Times Square. And he says the most brilliant guy became a millionaire selling potato peelers with a little wagon. He's a cute English guy, has his outgoing personality, talks to everybody, tells all these stories and jokes. And every day he makes a shitload of money. He did when he was alive. But he says one thing brilliant: never underestimate the accumulation of a lot of money consistently.
$10 at a time.
$10 at a time. And he became a millionaire. He had a beautiful apartment on Park Avenue. He put his daughter through college and everything, selling carrot peelers consistently. Okay. And that's one of the problems in our business. We hear all the gurus talk about the deal. Here's one deal and this other deal. You got to make money in between. You got to get out of the feast and famine. Very good. I got another video to show you guys. There's many different emotions. You guys like seeing commercials which use emotion. Everybody here know who Bryan Cranston is? What was the show he did? The really popular one. Help me out.
Breaking Bad.
Breaking Bad. Oh. Everybody. Did you know Bryan Cranston did commercials? Okay. And I found this really. I never saw this commercial before. I did a little homework for you guys. He did a commercial, and it. Let's see what emotion they're really using in this commercial here. This is a really. You'll love this.
Come out, wherever you are.
Anyone ever see this? I've never seen this commercial.
Mountain Dew Zero Sugar, with the same refreshing taste as the original, but without any of the sugar! Mountain Dew Zero.
I am thirsty.
Watch this. Wait a second.
Zero sugar.
Have you ever seen International Scouts commercials with the trunk monkey?
No.
Oh, they're so funny.
Okay, but let's stick with the commercial we just watched. Okay. Did anyone ever see that commercial, by the way? I've never seen
it. No.
In what movie? And he was, it was The Shining, Jack Nicholson, right? Mm. Real, just a takeoff on that commercial with Mountain Dew. What were they trying to do in that commercial emotionally? What were they going for?
Laughs, mainly.
Here.
Was it a little intent? Was it a little intent? I don't think I'd like little children to watch that commercial, frankly. It was a little intense. It was a little
that would get kids. That would get kids to stop drinking Mountain Dew. Right.
Yeah. It was shock. Was it? How did they get our attention so early on? That commercial. I mean, you really watch that commercial, don't you? Most of them we ignore.
They related to something that we already knew, and we wanted to see how they would do it differently.
Yeah, how they did it differently. We said, wait a second, don't I know that guy? That's Bryan Cranston, pretty popular actor. You know,
if you're making a sandwich in the kitchen, what's this woman screaming about? My God, it's a commercial.
Yeah. It's amazing how the media uses emotions in selling, even in these little 1 minute or 30 second or 15 second videos sometimes. I'm just amazed how they do it. How do you think we can do in terms of marketing? Should we use in a 1 minute, right now, 1 minute videos, I talk about them, the TikTok, Instagram, YouTube right now has YouTube Shorts. Check it out. Shorts. You can upload to your channel now 1 minute videos. They're very popular. You get a lot of hits from a 1 minute video if you've got a good topic in there. How do you make people emotional about real estate or whatever you're selling? In 1 minute, 60 seconds, what should you talk about?
How your product or service is going to make them feel.
Yeah. Okay. So if you're selling, back to our alarm company, what are you going to do in 60 seconds? What are you going to show? Grandma at home alone, and there's a knock on the door late at night.
A guy with an axe.
A guy with the axe. Okay, back to the axe. If you're selling another cute, what was that, Randy?
Carpet. Claude, I know you've got those brand new grandkids coming over, my friend. I know how much you love them grandkids. And you've had that racing gerbil farm in that room for God knows how long. No matter, I don't care how much you clean it, it's just not going to be up to snuff to have your grandkids crawl around on. You don't want your kids crawling around on that stuff, do you?
No, not really.
I mean, and we can come in, we can take care of it. That's not something you'd want to do right away, is it, before your grandkids come over for Christmas?
Yeah, you could do it that. You could, well, I mean, Christmas is right around the corner. Don't these things take weeks? How fast could you do that?
Claude, for you.
No, slow down. You're getting emotionally involved because you just heard a buying signal, didn't you? I want you to control your emotion. And slow it. Oh, that's a great question, Claude. Wow, what you must have asked that for a reason. This is how you pin me down. I'm painting myself in a corner if you don't overreact to that immediate buying signal. Slow it down a little and suck and make me close myself. Go ahead, let's do that. Well, you can't. Christmas is right around the corner. Yeah, doesn't it take weeks and weeks to order a carpet and the flooring and install it and everything? How soon could you do that?
Oh, it's difficult, Claude. It's difficult. But you must have asked that question for a reason.
Well, if I'm going to do this, you couldn't do it. Thanksgiving is around the corner. You couldn't do it before Thanksgiving, could you? We're only in October right now.
If I could, Claude, what would you say?
I'd say, I'm very interested. Tell me more. I'm ready to move.
Well, it's one of those things where I might be able to get you in. We're just so busy right now, but I would need to find out pretty soon from you. I mean, you know, is this something you want to go ahead with, or you want to just fire me and let's not worry about it? I know those grandkids are coming though.
I'll tell you right now, if you can give me a good price and get it in before Thanksgiving, you got a deal.
What'd you say?
You got a deal. If you can give me a fit, can you give me a great price?
I can, Claude. I can give you a great price. And
you're the most expensive. No, let's pretend you're the most expensive carpet installer in Georgia.
Claude, this is the same. This is the same carpet that we put into the White House for George Bush. It's a great deal. It's certainly not the least expensive, but it is the best carpet that you can buy. And it's for your grand. Is money an object with your grandkids?
Yeah, those little rugrats. Are you kidding me? They're so. Yeah, money's always important. Don't sell the money. Maybe sell customer service, quality of the guarantee. Tell me, Claude. You know what? We got a problem. I'm not the cheapest guy in town. I'm probably one of the more expensive ones. Why do you think we do that? Why do you think we sell our carpet, quality carpets, for more money, 20% more than our competition? Can you see the honesty of this dialogue and how you're going to win me over? Even though you're the most expensive, let's just do that one real quick. You're the most expensive. We've got a problem, Claude.
Claude, we got a small problem. We are not the cheapest in town. We're probably the most expensive in town. But we've been doing this for way over 20 years. Why do you think that is?
You probably 20 years, you're probably a good company.
We provide for our customers and we have a lot of repeat customers. And what would make you think that my customers are coming back all the time? Why do they always keep coming back?
I'm either thinking is your carpet better quality or guarantee or something, or the installation, or you're not sending, I had a brother-in-law and they sent a couple ex-cons to his house to install carpet. And they broke into it a week later. What kind of people do you hire to install this carpeting?
Well, my oldest installer has been with the company since we opened. He's been with us over 20 years. And people keep coming back because our superior customer service. Is that something you're interested in?
Okay, so if my wife's home alone, this is a trusted guy who's going to come over?
This is a trusted guy. This is a guy that's been working with us for over 20 years. Never had a complaint on him.
Okay, I feel bad. It's probably where you're not much more than you're what, 20% more, you said, or something?
We are a little bit more. Yes, sir, we're a little bit more, but we provide superior customer service and peace of mind. How important is that to you, where you know?
It's real important. I don't want my wife alone with somebody that I have to worry about, or I have to be there. I have to come home from work. That's real important to me. You got a deal.
What'd you say?
Yes, let's do this. If you can,
let's do it, Claude. I'll send you the paperwork over. You can have it by 3 this afternoon.
Give him a round. That was a good role play there. That was okay. I was tough on you there. Do you see how sometimes we can't read minds? Damn it! Isn't that horrible? Can you imagine?
It is.
Minds. But what was the one? What was the one thing that overcame all the price issues immediately?
Peace of mind.
Customer service.
His love and protection of his wife. The story he told you about his brother who had a carpet installed by criminals, okay?
Right.
Like that. Do you see how sometimes if we ask the right questions or we listen, we can emotionally close somebody and overcome all the objections of pricing and things like that?
Mm-hmm.
Price is not always the determining factor of a deal. It's a lot of other things. It's trust and things like that. I have another video here. Let me show another video here. Good stuff. You like talking about emotional selling? EQ, the emotional quotient. If we have time, I'll even show you my little mind map that I made up. I have another video here for you guys. You'll like this one. Let me see here. Am I sharing the screen? No, got to do that first.
Hey, Ralph, can I have a Dorito?
Sure. Pigs fly.
Oh, okay. Hey, Ralph.
Let me just mute.
Hey, dude.
Good boy.
I just love that. They went to all the trouble for that expression, when pigs fly. What was Doritos doing there? What were they doing besides the obvious humor? Cute kid. Always put kids or dogs in your videos, right? If you want to get attention, they, what do they call them? They're scene stealers all the time. Didn't we want to see that damn pig fly? However, right?
Suzanne, yeah, everybody's heard that emotion, that phrase.
Yeah. So a lot of them use humor. They can use fear. They can use love, tender moments, hugging the puppy. They can use all these different things. When we talk to somebody, what is one of the most important words to put an image, a picture in their mind? Okay, let's sell another dog here. Let me get another. This is my, let's see here. Here's my son's dog, Cedric. There's Cedric, not Newman. Mm-hmm. Okay. Nobody could sell Newman, also a cute dog. But let's see if some, Suzette, sell me Newman, sell me Cedric. Suzette, lovely Suzette, Maryland, Maryland. I'm a recently divorced guy. I'm 45 years old. I'm a little bit shy. And you have a really sweet rescue puppy, and you need to get rid of him today. Hello.
Hey, Claude. So how are you doing? Are you back in the game? Are you ready to start it fresh?
I'm divorced, and I'm living with her, I'm living with my mother-in-law. Figure that out. Did you ever meet somebody who get divorced and their parent and the spouse's parents liked the other one better than their own kid?
I've seen that.
Somebody's got a story like this. I'm okay. Thanks for asking, Suzette. And it gets a little lonely on Saturday night, but what are you gonna do?
So are you ready to start dating or maybe meeting somebody else? You might not be ready yet, are you?
I don't know. I'm a little shy and reluctant and inhibited and
nah, I don't think so. Why would you say that, Claude? Why would you say that?
I've been hanging around with Dave Skolnick too much. I don't know. I'm kidding, Dave.
Well, maybe you can call Dave and the two of you might go together and start fresh. Have you ever done like blind dating or stuff?
No, I don't want to do anything like that.
That's how we met.
Oh, brother. I'm not touching
that. So Claude, if it was the way that, imagine for a moment that you're ready to just start meeting people, not ready for dates, but maybe meeting people. I know you said you're a little uncomfortable, but what if there's a way that you could break that barrier and be able to meet other people? So other people approach you.
Oh, that'd be great.
Okay.
What do I have to do? Wear $100 suit? $100 bills hanging off a suit or?
Oh, that sounds like a good idea, Claude. But what if I have something better for you? Would you be up for it? Would you like to know more about it?
Yeah, tell me.
So I have this wonderful puppy. Look at him. Look at this beautiful blue bow. What do you think that when you're sitting somewhere and you have this beautiful puppy in your lap, don't you think that somebody will come to you and want to pet your little doggy?
You mean if I go outside on the beach or take a walk around?
Yes. Where would you like to be, Claude? Where do you like to go?
Wow. I go to a coffee shop every morning. I take a long walk. You mean if I had a cute little puppy, I might be able to make new friends?
I don't know. Would that be something that you're interested in?
That's what we're talking. Give me a guarantee now. Go into a gap. We'll talk about this maybe next week. Guarantee mode. Give me a guarantee right now.
So if I could guarantee that this puppy will make you new friends, maybe a cute one, you know, and open the opportunity and open the door for have new conversations and new people around, would you be up for it?
Immediately? Yeah, what do I have to do? Is there a fee? Do I have to pay you something? I love this dog. He's so cute. Now, you think I'll get a new girlfriend here by Friday?
I don't know. Well, I can guarantee you that at least you will meet somebody. I cannot tell you as a girlfriend, but I can guarantee you that at least you'll meet somebody for sure. Because who can resist this beautiful puppy? Nobody. So you definitely be able to meet somebody. Okay. What do you think?
I think you you sold me. How much?
Okay, I don't know. How much do you think you would? How much do you think you could afford right now?
Whatever the vet bills are, he's a rescue. Rescue all you can pay the vet bills and a shot and everything. All right, good. I put you on the hot seat there. That's a tough one. We can sell animals emotionally for a lot of different reasons, like they did in the Subaru commercial. Maybe I'm just a lonely guy. I want to meet people. What happens, by the way, when you have a cute puppy and you're taking a walk in a public place? What do people do?
They're chick magnets.
They're all kind of magnet. Can you start a conversation, even a couple that has a cute dog? Can you, and you sell life insurance, so you like talking and meeting the people. We always talk about engaging people every day. Can you engage somebody who has a dog on the street? What would you say to say, oh, that's a nice dog. Oh, is that a friendly dog? That looks like a great dog. How long have you had him? Can you start conversations with people real easy?
Yep.
Yeah, definitely.
Engaging people all day long, even non-business related, is good practice, because then, and we talked about this last week, about being spontaneous, about improvisational. Okay, can we start a conversation with somebody off the script and ask questions, tell stories, and get them and get them so emotionally involved that they make a that we can feel very comfortable in our own skin, you know, build up our confidence on there. I have a mind map here. I'm going to go to it real quick. I have one more. Now, you know what? Let's see. Too much stuff and the time is gone. Doggone it. Time goes. One more commercial and I'll send everybody the mind map. I have a lot of good notes on it and I'll post it in the Skype group today. Let me do one more commercial before we go. Let's see here. There we go.
I found you so long ago.
Angel.
On an endless road.
Hey.
Oh, I found you.
Go home.
Angel. Hi. I'm so worried.
Sorry. It won't happen again.
Now.
Notice the car she's driving, by the way.
Go get it. There you go.
Is there something?
Come on, let's go home.
On your mind.
After 10 years, we've covered a lot of miles.
Looking for me too.
Good thing I got a Subaru.
Looks like you got out again, huh, Banjo?
I found you.
Nice.
What is out there? Find it in a
circle.
Really good.
Tell me how great these commercials are.
Fantastic.
And the whole point of today's discussion, I'll show you the mind map real fast here. Can you guys, let's see, I got a screen share first. Here's a little mind map I made up. I've got some role plays here. There's three different types of emotional experiences that are subjective, physiological, behavioral. The why. Why does a salesperson need to control their fear? How do they control with questions, stories? Who should use emotions or emotional selling? Good definition here. The EQ, emotional intelligence known as EQ, is the ability to understand, use, and manage your own emotions in positive ways to realize stress, communicate effectively, empathize, is a word we use very often with others, overcome challenges, and diffuse conflict. Emotional intelligence refers to the ability to identify and manage one's own emotions as well as the emotions of others. very important in the gut sales system. It's emotional selling, and we utilize questions. We put images and pictures in people's mind. But what's the million-dollar rule before I go here? Last thing, what is that million-dollar rule?
Selling
most people make emotional decisions immediately.
Justify logically.
Just right later.
People, I see this all the time. The great salespeople, the salespeople who make more money in a week than other people will make in a year, use emotional-based selling. They control their own emotions. Okay, I'm a guy who wears his heart on his sleeve. I cry at Disney movies. Okay, when I'm selling, I'm responsible for controlling. Do you ever get a person who's a nudge who just drives you crazy and everything? You want to lash out on them? A great salesperson controls their emotions.
Daniel Goldman wrote about that in his book, Emotional Intelligence.
Who was that? I'm sorry?
Daniel Goldman.
Daniel Goldman, what book was that?
EQ, Emotional Intelligence.
EQ, Emotional Damage. Okay, great. Cialdini talks about a lot of good books talk about it. Emotional selling is the key, but you have to be responsible for your own emotions.
Oh, yeah.
Create emotions in other people, and then go. And then once you've qualified them, you know how to go right to the close, the third step in the gut sales method. Did we learn something today?
Yes.
Absolutely.
Good, good. Jessica, how are you?
Good. I'm here in Belgrade. Belgrade, Serbia, Europe.
Belgrade,
just thought I'd tune in. It's almost 7 p.m.
All right. How's the food in Belgrade?
It's good. It's good. All right. And the people are so nice. So nice. I'm doing this new anti-aging procedure.
All right.
Yeah, with stem cells.
Well, let me know if it works.
Yeah. I will. I'm already looking younger.
Randy, you're not going to look like her.
Hey, I think David Skolnick used it recently. He's only 26 years old. I'm taking cheap shots, David. I'm sorry.
I know.
Well, I hope everything works out well. Everybody, have a wonderful week. Go out there, talk to people, make money, ask questions, and use the EQ so you go to the bank, because nobody deserves success more than you. Let's get a little music.
Take us out with Michael Jackson, Thriller, because it's the Halloween soon.
Thriller. Oh, let's see if we can find Thriller.
Can you?
Let's see. Is that what it's called,
Thriller? Days before Halloween.
I'll see if I can find it. You keep the audience entertained while I'm filing Thriller here. All right.
Happy Monday, everybody.
Happy Monday.
Bye, happy Monday.
Money for Monday.
What's everyone doing for Halloween this year? Any
more
parties?
More money for Monday.
I'm trick-or-treating.
You trick-or-treating, Claude?
Wait, you know what? Let's get the video. This is a great video.
Yes, it is.
Let me see if I can find the Thriller video.
I think it's the most all-time, it's sold the most, they've sold more singles than any other song, I think, the Thriller, isn't it? I think so.
Oh yeah, it's a biggie. Here we go.
Next week, do Monster Mash.
Yeah.
Um, 13 minutes long, wow.
Oh, that is long. That's the long version.
Now let me get
that's the longest song that he ever wrote.
You got the extended version on there.
Yes. I have something I want to tell you.
Yes, Michael.
I love children.
Of course. That's why I love you. I mean, I'm different. What are you talking about?
I like it.